Good morning. Welcome to worship. This is the third Sunday after Easter, or the third Sunday of our Easter season. And I just want to reflect on the fact that yesterday was such a pretty day. I hope you all were able to be out and to be in it. And today's going to be another good day. It's going to be warm today, so time to be out and about as much as you can be. I was telling some earlier that I was at Ritter Park yesterday afternoon walking my dog, and I almost didn't get a place to park down there. And I couldn't imagine. I must have forgotten some festival or something that was going on. And when I finally got a place to park and got out, I saw all these sparkles all over the place. It was girls in prom dresses and fellows dressed in their tuxes or suits. It was prom and picture time. What a wonderful place to take pictures. So welcome. We're going to have a good time together in worship. Welcome to those of you who are here and to those of you who are joining us virtually. We're glad to have you.
Good morning. I'm Alan Simmons, and I'll be serving as your lector this morning. Please rise as you are able and join me as we read responsively the call to worship from your bulletins and from the video screens above. How joyful it is to celebrate the good news of God's love. We are called to be Easter people. Darkness cannot claim us. Fear cannot bind us. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Amen.
our worship service this morning. Creating and loving God, we recognize and are eternally grateful for the love you have revealed to us through your only Son, Jesus Christ. We are called to be your children. Resurrect in us a trusting faith. Illuminate the path in which you would have us follow, and unlock our ability to love as you love, so that we may extend your love to all your children and creation. In your name we pray. Amen.
The first scripture this morning comes from the New Testament, the book of Acts, chapter 3, verses 12 through 19, reading from the Common English Bible. Seeing this, Peter addressed the people, "You Israelites, why are you amazed at this? God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus. This is the one you handed over and denied in Pilate's presence, even though he had already decided to release him. You rejected the holy and righteous one and asked that a murderer be released to you instead. You killed the author of life, the very one whom God raised from the dead. We are witnesses of this. His name itself has made this man strong. That is, because of faith in Jesus' name, God has strengthened this man whom you see and know. The faith that comes through Jesus gave him complete health right before your eyes. Brothers and sisters, I know you acted in ignorance. So did your rulers. But this is how God fulfilled what he foretold through all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer. Change your hearts and lives. Turn back to God so that your sins may be wiped away." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Now comes time for us to share in our prayers of intercession. You note in your bulletin that we have a list of folks for whom we are praying, and I know there are people and things you have on your hearts for which we also pray. And to get us started with that, I want to have a special prayer today for our general conference that's going to be coming up. We have members of our congregation who are part of our West Virginia Annual Conference delegation who will be going to Charlotte, North Carolina to attend General Conference. For those of you who may not know, General Conference, it's a meeting of our entire worldwide United Methodist Church, and they have some things to consider and some things that will be voted on and amended and brought forth, and it's a very important time. We haven't been able to meet because of COVID and various things, so they have a lot on their plates. And I know there's a lot of reading to do. I'm told they had a stack of things that was about this high that they had to go through. So Jeff Taylor and Kim Matthews are going to be representing us on our West Virginia Annual Conference delegation who goes. And there are a few others on the team who you will note. Joe and Judy Keniston, who I know you're familiar with. Joe Hill, who is another name I know you know. They will all be going and attending as well. So let's have a prayer as we get started to pray for them and for all those who will be coming, going to General Conference to represent us and the interests of the church in the name of the Lord. Let's pray. Almighty and everlasting God, we give you thanks for the unique expression of your church through the people called United Methodists. You have granted us spiritual ancestors whose words and witness have shaped our practice, our polity, and our doctrine. We pray for the work of the General Conference, and we entrust to your care those who are serving as delegates and representatives, that you might strengthen them with physical and mental stamina to conduct their business with courage, mutual love, and spiritual centeredness. We pray for their long hours of work and their short nights of rest. We pray for safety in their travels. We pray for a renewed commitment to the central command of Jesus, which is to make disciples of all nations. Guide the delegates toward an unrelenting focus on that ideal, that it may guide every decision. We pray for clarity in the way the agency's programs and fiscal activities of the church will be evaluated for their effectiveness. And may the work of this general conference impact the United Methodist Church on all levels, from the general boards to the grassroots, from the ordained to the laity, from local communities to contexts all around the world. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Now I want us to have our prayer of intercession, again, for those things on our hearts and those people who we have on our list who need healing or who need the Lord's intervention and help in some way. So let's look to the Lord for our prayers of intercession in this way. O Lord of blessings, mercy, grace, and love, you call us from the darkness of sin into your light of life. You call us to love and witness to all the world. Be with us as we serve you by serving others through our prayer, our prayers, our church, in our community, our area, our nation, and our world. Guide us, empower us to be your faithful disciples, shining your light for those in need. Bring your healing and restoration to bear as needed. We pray in the name of Jesus, our Redeemer, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
I want to share with you a reading that comes to us from 1 John. From 1 John chapter 3, begin with verse 1 and following. Hear these words. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know Him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when He is revealed, we will be like Him, for we will see Him as He is. And all who have this hope in Him purify themselves just as He is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that He was revealed to take away sins, and in Him there is no sin. No one who abides in Him sins. No one who sins has either seen Him or known Him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as He is righteous. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Oh God, we thank You for Your words to us this day and ask now that You would open our hearts, our minds, and our senses to what it is You would speak to us. Amen. You know, I don't want to alarm anybody, and I wasn't out enjoying the sunshine and weather so much yesterday that I caught something. I actually have allergies, and they're just flaring up. I'm not used to them coming this quickly in the spring, because when I was up north, things didn't bud out and pollinate and that kind of thing quite so quickly. So I'm off today to get Allegra or some such medication. I actually went into Express Care Place and checked yesterday, so I'm fine, other than allergies. Easter is something we equate with spring, and rightly so. Springtime is the time of year when new life emerges from the old, and we always think of Jesus' death and resurrection, His resurrection to new life, something that came about as a rebirth, which is beginning of rebirth and salvation for all of us who are born into sin by way of the first discretions that took place, and that has come upon all of us. We might think about how surprised it was the disciples were, the women, the men, those who went to the tomb expecting to see a dark and dim place in the early morning hours when the sun had not yet fully appeared. But they found an empty tomb. And later, they would find that the tomb was empty because Christ had risen. Christ was alive. Hallelujah. From that point, they began to see Jesus, and He showed Himself to people in different places at different times as a witness to the truth of the resurrection, that He was indeed alive. Now, some of you know, and I think it was put on our email pages, that I last weekend was gone, and I took some vacation days and went to be with family. We had a family eclipse party. Now, we did that in 2017 as well, down near Knoxville, where one of my nieces and her family lived, and a bunch of us gathered down there and had a wonderful time celebrating each other and the total eclipse we saw there. And we were in Uniontown, Ohio last weekend and Monday for the total eclipse that we were able to see there. And that's just south of Akron, for those of you who may not know. We joined about 30 million people, I've read, in the United States who would have had privy to see this total eclipse, and others who saw partial eclipse take place. And that doesn't count all the people in Mexico and Canada who were able to see it at this particular time in this particular year, this spring. And I want us to think a little bit about how that might relate and how I'm trying to relate that to our story of Jesus and the resurrection and the light and darkness that we experience in our lives. We have to go back 2,000 years ago or more to Jesus' crucifixion and think about what it was that took place. Jesus was the light of the world who came into the world. And people didn't recognize, all people didn't recognize who Jesus was and the significance of that. But he came and he knew what he had come to do, to take away the sins of the world so we might all have life and light eternally. He was put to death, which was indeed a dark day. In fact, the sky even darkened, it tells us, for about 3 hours' time. And it was a dark few days. While he was entombed, there was sadness. The disciples and those who knew Jesus and loved him didn't know what to do. They weren't sure what would happen next. They didn't understand everything that he'd been telling them, so they were in despair. But then, on the third day, they found the tomb was empty, and that would give them hope. When they began to see Jesus, and even in one of the Gospels, it tells us that Mary Magdalene recognized him eventually when he called out her name in the garden. What a light had come back into their lives, into our world, for her to recognize that Jesus was alive again, as he said he would be. Well, in my experience of the eclipse, I began to think about these scripture passages and things I've been reading, and I started to think about that and what the significance of that was and how I experienced this sort of thing. And I believe when we met together, we weren't sure if it was going to be a cloudy day or what, but it was fortunately enough, the clouds had dispersed, that we were able to see the total eclipse. It was incredible. And up to that point, the sun was shining brightly. And gradually, darkness began to come over where we were. And it took a while. It was a slow burn. And as you're looking at me, it would have come this way, over the sun. And indeed, it did grow dark. And I think about how it is that the light of Christ came into the world and shone brightly for all who would see, for all who would believe. And gradually, sin overtook their minds, their thinking, and darkness fell over all of them. But the light wasn't put out. Even as the total eclipse happened, we were able to take our glasses off, and we were able to see the corona, the light shining around the moon that we could see. And not only could we see that, there's something called Bailey's bits, I think. And it was little sparks of light that you could see as the rays of the sun would hit some of the mountains and valleys that were on the moon's surface. And then there was something that was at about 7 o'clock as we looked up at the moon and the eclipse, and it was a bright light that shone separately from everything else. And it was a little bit of a pinkish, reddish color. And to me, that was a reminder of the fact that even though darkness had come upon the earth, Jesus died a real death, a physical death, there was still a glimmer of hope, because behind the darkness, the light was still shining. The light of God was still there. And as the moon began to move, as our planet began to move, the light began to come back and return. And as we are born basically into light, although we are prone to sin, sin is a part of who we are, even when we're born. That darkness of sin grows as we grow, and as we are in the world and of the world before we get to know the light of Christ. And so darkness overcomes us in our lives. And it's when we are able to see a shimmering light, a beam of light, a speck of light that draws us to it, to pull us out of the darkness, to pull us to new life. We are doomed, but that light is there, and it's always there, and will always be there. And so for me, as a person of sin who has been redeemed, I believe that as darkness came over my life, there was a point at which I knew there was something better for me. And when I began to look for Jesus, Jesus was there. And Jesus was ready to help me out of the darkness into the light. And that sin that had been a part of who I was, that had darkened my life, began to turn into light. And more of the light appeared, and less of the darkness remained. Now that's what I think Peter is calling those to whom he spoke that Alan shared with us in Acts. You can have life. Remember, Jesus is for you. But you need to do certain things to make sure that you're on Jesus' side, that you have Christ in your life, that you have the light of Christ that's welling up inside. When we become Christians and accept Christ as Savior, the Holy Spirit comes to live in us. That's the light of Christ. And when that Holy Spirit is there, its potential is immeasurable as long as we allow that to come out, to come up, and to shine forth. And that's what we're called to do. Now, does that mean as Christians, as it talks about here, that we are to live for perfection, or we call it in our United Methodist terminology, sanctifying grace, that which helps to change us from who we have been into that perfect image of Christ, which is what we all need to strive for as Christian believers, which can come to us, but it takes some time for that to happen, for the light to dispel the darkness in our lives, for Christ to get rid of the sin in our hearts and in our lives. And yes, sometimes we fall back into sin, but our perspective is changed once we have had that light come into us. We don't see sin in the same way, and we recognize it. And I've mentioned this before, that I think when we have accept Christ as Savior and we have the Holy Spirit living in us, that becomes our new conscience and way of seeing things and seeing the world and seeing ourselves. And we may, some people would say we're convicted when we know that we have done something wrong that we shouldn't have done. And we're given an opportunity to make that right and to be forgiven and to try again. God is good, and God loves us and wants that for us. So when I didn't share all that with my family about what I saw in the eclipse, but I have a feeling that some of them may have seen something similar to that or something the same as well. I'm fortunate that those of us who met together, 17 of us, and most of us were Christian believers. Now, some of the children are too young yet to have decided on that, and some are not United Methodists, so they haven't already been baptized, but we love them anyway. But I know that it had an effect on us all, because we have led spiritual lives and have shared some of those kinds of things together. And as we began to see the eclipse, we just got quiet and we took it all in. Not that it was some magical thing or some mystical thing that happened, but it did have meaning for us. And for me, when I think about how light can come from the darkness, that is so significant for all of us, because no matter where it is we find ourselves, no matter in what a dark place we may find ourselves, as the Gospel of John says in chapter 1, verse 5, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness does not extinguish the light. Nothing is worse and so bad that the light of Christ can't make a difference. No one is to a place in their life where they're fallen so far away that the light of Christ can't come in and change their life for the better. Now, as Christians believers, That's something that we are called to share as our witness. That's something that we are called to share and to shine the light of Christ for others to see, because there are plenty of people who still languish in darkness, the darkness of sin in this world. John talks about the fact that what we will be has not yet been revealed, but we do have the promise of something special. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. We will one day have the privilege of seeing Almighty God in all his glory, in all God's glory, in all God's power. And we will have an even greater privilege of in some way sharing in that divine experience with God. And that is something that we are given, and that's something that we are given to share. In just a few minutes, we're going to be sharing a couple of meals, one downstairs and one up here, the first one up here. We're going to be sharing in our Holy Sacrament of Communion, sharing the Lord's Supper, and we share that as a community of believers. I was given an interesting article that was written by Timothy Dolan, but it was actually part of it was written from, he's a Cardinal Dolan, and he's a Roman Catholic Archbishop of New York, and it was about how important it is for us to be joined together as believers in the body of Christ, Christian community, and that's what communion is, that we share something together. And this is a meal that the Lord sets before us, that we come together to share, and it's important to shine our light for those of us who are shining light as encouragement, as support, and also to remember who we are and whose we are. Jesus has not left us without a sign of his resurrection, and that's something we want to remember. We have this sacrament of communion, that new life occurs from old life, that light shines in the darkness. And as we receive Holy Communion as a family, a body of believers together, Christ is truly present with us. The table is set before us, and we believe that the Lord is in it, and the Holy Spirit is in it and can speak to us. We know that the bread that we have, the wafers, the unleavened, and the gluten-free, whatever it may be, is a simple, plain bread. But when it comes to being made one of the elements, as Jesus shared the bread with his disciples, it's made into a witness of his body, crucified, yet risen, dead to the darkness of sin, but risen to new life and light. The common juice that we use is made into a witness of his blood, shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins, which is part of our wording in our ritual. So as we share in this sacramental meal together, we proclaim to the world and to one another that we are indeed children of God, saved by grace, brought from darkness into light. God the Father has sent God's Son for us, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, we believe and are witnesses to the love of God for all people through Jesus Christ. The light still shines. No matter how bad it looks in the world, no matter how many things seem to happen that we don't have control over, the light still shines. And we want to be part of that light. Let us look to the light to shine that for others. The light still shines. In John's Gospel, John writes, "This light shines in the darkness, and the darkness does not extinguish it." Let's remember that, and let's live it. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Please join me as we read the prayer of confession together. Gracious God, you give to us your greatest gift, your Son, Jesus Christ, as we still don't understand what is going on. You call us to be people of courage and hope, and yet we run and hide, doubting and fearing. You challenge us to proclaim our faith, but we huddle in darkness, whispering our words of discouragement. Shake us up, Lord. Forgive us when we seem to need prodding over and over again. Help us to see the presence of Jesus in our lives and remind us of all that he taught us to help us live as disciples, serving you by serving others. Change us, remold us, make us truly the disciples you have called us to be. Amen.
Receive assurance of the pardon that is extended to us as we confess our sins before the Lord. The Lord calls us and says, "Do not be afraid. The light of God has vanquished the darkness. Christ is risen. Doubts are erased. Rejoice. God's love is poured upon you now and forever. Amen." Now I'm going to, before I call up the ushers, I want to extend the invitation to the Lord's table that we'll be sharing in this meal together in just a moment. The Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. We have confessed our sin before God and one another. Glory to God. Amen. Now it's time for us to give of ourselves and our gifts that we bring before the Lord for all that the Lord has given to us, as I ask the ushers to come forward to receive our morning's offering. We come before you bringing our gifts of tithes and offering of ourselves. We thank you for all the many blessings you have graciously bestowed upon us. And we plan and hope and long to be good stewards of what you've given us and to be your faithful disciples. We love you and thank you for the love you have poured out on us to bring us out of the darkness into the light of your love. We pray these things together, that they may be tokens of our willingness to serve you, and that our gifts may serve others in your name. We pray it through Jesus Christ. Amen. Now it's time for us. We have received an invitation to come to the table to share in this meal together. And it's time for us to do that. The table has been set and prepared for us. We have here the individual sealed cups for those of you who may prefer these, with the wafer and the bread and the juice together. We have gluten-free. And we also have juice in the cup. We will share together by intinction as we break bread, share it with you, and then dip it in the cup and take it. Hear these words of great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. In love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin, when we had fallen into sin and turned away, and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, brought us to a land flowing with milk and honey, and set before us the way of life. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and spirit. By your great mercy, we have been born anew to a living hope, through the resurrection of your Son from the dead, and to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. Once we were no people, but now we are your people, declaring your wonderful deeds in Christ, who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from you all of this. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." On the day you raised him from the dead, he was recognized by his disciples in the breaking of the bread, and in the power of your Holy Spirit, your church has continued in the breaking of the bread and the sharing of the cup. And so in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. As we proclaim the mystery of faith, Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Now, if the servers would come, I have some help today. Oops. Now, would you receive a benediction? And just before I do that, though, I've been reminded, graciously reminded, that we are having a luncheon downstairs. The United Methodist men have been working hard to prepare this for us and plan it and cook it. The main entree is beef tenderloin, but if you are vegetarian or do not eat red meat, there is salmon as an alternative. That's limited, but beef tenderloin is the main entree, I'm told. And looking forward to that. And they are preparing this and have done this for us as a memorial luncheon for Joe Neal, and we will be taking donations as you feel led to give. Receive a blessing. May you go with God, who loves you and instills in you courage and peace to share the good news of the gospel with a world languishing in darkness. Shine the light of God's redemptive power, proclaiming to all through your witness of what God in Christ can do. Go to love and serve the Lord.